Welcome back to class. We are missing Koi and
Miss Party.
Koi and Ben is there and Bao. Yeah. Man, Bao is always the first one here when we use Zoom, and now he's always the last one. For some reason. Alright. So let's take a 2 or 3 minutes to recap. Yesterday we learned about testing, right? So why do we test? What did you learn from testing yesterday? You saw a lot of bugs in your code. And then you go back, and you went back, fixed the code, and make it work, make a test pass, right? So by testing, you can actually see a lot of errors in different places that you don't even expect. Like yours yesterday?
That's not only with the...
Yeah, but yeah, you will see the error, the bugs that you have in different places you don't even expect to see, right? And by writing tests, you can find all of them. Also, writing tests can make you like you understand more about your code, just like refactoring. Actually, yeah. And people actually use professional. They use tests a lot. They test a lot, and there are positions just for testing. Right. Just like how you can create a new software, there are also positions in the company just to test. Like they do testing the whole day, the whole month, the whole year. Yeah. Tester, they call tester, unit tester, something like that. So if you like test, you can apply for those positions. But enough about that. You don't have to worry too much in your final project about testing. It's a nice like plus if you have tests in your code. You can like brag about it. Hey, I have a bunch of tests in my code to make sure that everything works fine. But when you demo, something wrong. Right. So today we will learn about OAuth, and in the lab we will learn how to log in with third-party service. For example, like Facebook, Google, Twitter, GitHub, those kind of services, they provide us the OAuth feature here, so we can use it to log in into our applications. Right. And also the next part we also learn how to implement the authentication between front end and back end. It's kind of tricky the first time you do it, but as soon as you get the flow, and it's going to be okay. Right. So here are some theory. Before we had OAuth. Like it's long before, like in 2000, for example, even earlier. For example, right here you have three entities: you, the user, and service provider, which can be Twitter or Google or Facebook. We call them service provider, and we have the backend here, or the applications you can call API. And before us. For example, if you want to log in into a website with your Twitter account or Facebook account, you have to provide them the username and the password. And that means your API, the backend server or the application, they have your password, your username and your password. And that will lead to a bunch of problems and limitations. Right? You don't want, actually, these are, you don't want to provide them, you don't want to send them the password. Your Facebook password, Google password. So that's why there are a bunch of problems and limitations. First, the application will store your password somewhere in your database, right? And for some reason, the maintainer or the administrator, they have complete access to your account. Because they have your password, they have your email, they have your username, so they can access to your account. And you cannot revoke access to an app. For example, I have an app and I have your password, I have your username. I don't use it for any other purpose, but for some reason you feel insecure and you want to revoke my access to your account so that you have no way but changing your own password. So that's the old way. This is the old days. And if my website or my database is leaked, your password is leaked too. Right. I cannot hash it because if I hash it, I cannot use the password to log in the account. So I have to store a raw password. And this, those are the problems and limitations.
Cool. So nowadays, like administrators cannot access your account anymore.
Yeah. So now the developers, they kind of like found another way to do the authentication. And yeah, they recognize the problems, right? Those problems. The services here, I mean like Google, Twitter, Facebook, they recognize the problems. And they try to implement something that's similar to Auth1. Right now you don't know Auth1, but it's basically, if you go to git netlify here.com, right? Oh, sorry. Okay, you want to register an account. You either choose email and password, or you either use login with GitHub, GitLab, Bitbucket, or email, or maybe Google. So those kind of stuff called OAuth. And right now we have OAuth version 2.0. But before that, we had OAuth 1. Basically, they are very similar, OAuth 1 and OAuth 2. So the services, they try to implement something like very similar to OAuth. But at that time, there's no standard. That means like they don't work well with each other. If you want to implement something called authentication with a third-party service, then back then you have to do it differently for each service. For example, Google, you have to code differently from Facebook or from GitHub. And that's why they came up with a standard, and that is OAuth. So for example, before that, Flickr, they have something called Flickr Auth, and they use token prop, I don't know which proxy, but they kind of like use a lot of sub on their own term. Google, they have a system called AuthSub. Facebook, they use a hash, and they have to sign it with MD5. Yahoo, they call BB browser-based auth. So they all have something similar to OAuth, but there's no standard. Like they have no something in similar. Like people, developer have to code differently for each service. And that's why they all came up with OAuth 1. And OAuth 1 works pretty much similar to the OAuth 2, which is the current standard we're using now. On the surface, that's it. But on the backend side, it's kind of different. I will show you the difference in the next couple of slides. And the user doesn't have to provide a password anymore. Instead, they will be redirected to another website, which is the third-party service. For example, here, I will click login with GitHub. I will be redirected to another page, maybe. Yeah, so I already have that account, sorry. So I have to log out. GitLab. Actually, you will see it. I'm redirected to another page very quickly. But then, so GitLab. Then here, you ask me, GitLab, see? I'm redirected to GitLab, and GitLab will ask me the permission if I have an account already. It will ask me permission in order to log in Netlify. So basically, the backend server doesn't store any password. That's good. That fixes the problem. But there's another problem. OAuth1 is very hard to use for developers because it's use something called a request at the site with MD5 hash. Very similar to Facebook, and it's very hard to use for a developer. There's a bunch of steps in order to get the information from the service. So, and that's why they came up with OAuth 2.0. It was like in 2013, I think, right? And the side request here with MD5 here, it will be replaced by the tokens. Yes, replaced by the token. And that token will be sent over the HTTPS, and we'll see in the next slide. Okay. So here's how the OAuth works, OAuth 2 work. So we have a couple of terms, definition here. If you read on the documentation or read on some article on the internet, you will see these terms: resource owner, which is the owner of the account, for some of you, me, Koi. And we have resource server, which is So that's a server that store our information. You call it Facebook, Google, GitHub, GitLab, for example. We also have authorization server, which is most of the time they are the same. So the resource server and the authorization server are basically the same. In most case, in some rare case, you have a different server, but most of the time you have they are the same server. And lastly, we have the client, which is the backend application. The client here means the client from the point of view of the third party, the service here. So they call it client. But from our perspective, our client is the user, right? So the term here is standing on the perspective of the service provider. So we have four terms here, and here's the illustration. Too small, right? So we, now we are the user, right? We want to log in for example, Netlify. So we want to log in Netlify. We visit their front end application, and then we decide to log in with Netlify. So we click on a button or a link or anything, and they will redirect us, right? Redirect us to GitLab here. Redirect us to GitLab. Look at the color here. The black color means redirect. Okay. So it will redirect us to the authentication server, which is GitLab. Or in my picture here is Facebook. And then Facebook will ask permission from the user. And if we accept, means we type in the password, username, and password. That means we accept. If we don't accept, we can click cancel or deny or no. And that will result in two different cases here, error or success. If it's an error, it also redirect us to the backend server, right? The backend server with an error code. If it's successful, it will redirect to the backend as well, but this time with an access token. So that's why I say token. So here's the difference between OAuth 1 and OAuth 2. OAuth 1 doesn't have this step, backend server to resource server. Instead, it goes straight down here. Okay. And OAuth 2 actually have one more step. It doesn't send you the information right away. It sends you a token. And then on the backend server, your thread app or your Node.js app will use that token. And then we will send a request. And blue color here, send a request, make a request, HTTP request, HTTPS request to resource server, which is Facebook again. They are different, right? They are different. Authentication server and resource server. This request, we expect to receive the user information with this token, right? And when we got the user information back then, we will have a couple of steps here. We will save the user to our database without any password. We don't need password anymore. So we save the user to our database. For example, we can find user with the email we got from here. And if there's no email, that means we don't have that user in our database. We can create another account for that user. So the process here, there are a bunch of things that we have to do here. We can create a token for the user as well, for the first time they log in or the register. And that, after all of that, we will redirect the user back to the front end app. And the whole flow here, that's the only time that we actually allow the user to see our backend. This is the only like feature that we allow the user to see our backend. Normally, we don't want the user to directly see our backend at all. What they see is just front end, right? And behind the scene, behind the wall, front end will communicate with the backend server. And the user should not know anything about that. User should only see the front end. But here, this feature here, we actually redirect user to the backend server. And we actually redirect again to the Facebook. And then Facebook will redirect it back to the server. And then after we register or log the user in, we will redirect again. So we have one, two, three, four redirect. That's why when you log in with GitLab or Google, it takes like longer.
Is this the backend run or this is the auth server?
What do you mean? This one?
Yeah.
Oh, this is the auth server, authentication server here,
so
right
where
here.
Was the backend server?
It's their server. You don't see them.
Yeah.
It's Flask, so it Flask very quickly. You don't actually see them. And here, if I click cancel, I go back here. So this is their backend server. It depends. If they have front end and back end separately, like React and Node.js, so this is the front end, but behind the scene, you hardly see the back end. If I click on Bitbucket, see, ABI notified. This is their back end, right? And then it redirects us to Bitbucket, which is the authentication server. And then if I log in, it will redirect me to the backend again, and then backend will send request to Facebook, for example, to get the information, the user information. It happened so quickly we don't even see it.
It's when the address is like changed.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's one case. That's for the single page app application front end application. If they decide to use the server side front end, which means it's kind of like our handlebars. It happened. It's actually happened a little bit different, but the process is the same. You will not see the redirect here if you do it on the server side rendering, which means your front end will be attached to your server back end as well.
You mean with a different route?
No, not really different route, but all of these you will lose one redirect here. You don't have to redirect here, I think. So we are not gonna learn that, so don't worry too much about it, right? As long as you get the flow here first, it's okay. This is what we're gonna use for the whole course, right? And that we have a token. For example, if I log in here, they will redirect me back to their server with a token. And that token, they will use that token and send a request to Facebook resource server in order to get the user information, right? And then we save the user information into their database. And user information here are just, for example, username, name, email, photos, public photo for Facebook, for avatar, for example. They don't have password at all. They can have the unique ID from Facebook, but they don't have passwords. And they will save all of those information into a database. And then they can either create a token for the user. This token is different from this token. This is the token between Facebook and the backend. And now here, backend will create a token for the front end only. And it will send that token to the front end. And from then, front end will use that token to communicate with backend. We already know this step, right? We already learned this step before. For example, your ABI key when you call movie, your ABI key when you call GitHub issues, for some those kind of keys are actually the key that's generated by the back end in order to use in the front end, right? Okay, so this flow here, you have to get, know this flow, understand the whole flow, in order to not get lost, okay? So you can either take a picture or save the picture somewhere. Go to this URL, save the picture somewhere. That's very good.
It's not on the learning
model? I actually wrote this one yesterday. On the learning talk, we have another flow. It's kind of the same, but it's not that as clear as the one on these slides. So basically, we also have the client and the user here, right? So it's more about English here. This flow is more English. It's less technical, it's more English. So we start here, right? A user will want to log in with Facebook, for example. This is too small. I want to log in with Facebook. So I send the request to the client, mean our front end. I send a request to backend. I actually redirect to backend, right? And backend will ask the third party server, Facebook, for example, I want my client want to log in with your service, okay? do, and then backend will ask the user, do you accept it or not? If you don't accept it, so there one line missing. Okay, let's assume that we accept, the user accept, right? So sure, I have, let's give them some informations. And then the property will receive that response from the user, and it will send a token to the backend, and the backend will use that token to get the information, right? So that token is only used between backend and Facebook. And then backend, we have all of those information. We'll send it back to the client, which is our front end app. Okay. So it's more about English. So we have two tokens. And you are less likely to work with this token. Right? This token is used automatically between the backend and the authentication server. You don't need to worry about this token. Just know that it exists. It's there, but you don't actually need to work with it. All you have to worry is this token. And this token, you have to handle it on the front end. Okay? What?
No, this is like we are signing the player in our tic-tac-toe.
Yeah, it's different. In tic-tac-toe, we actually log in with Facebook, but that's a front end login. It's less secure. It's less secure.
You just send a token from the Facebook to our app, so
there's no token there, actually.
Yeah, but what we have we cannot invite the all.
But there's some cons that you can create a fake information, right? You can create your fake information and then you send to backend, and backend doesn't know it. The problem is we don't want to deal with data on the front end. It's like the user can modify the data on the front end. They can actually open console log or console here. And if we store data in local storage or session storage, they can actually directly modify it. For example, we have a bunch of cookies here, right? I can actually modify it. And then it will cause a lot of security problems. So be careful when you work with local storage. People can actually modify anything. So it's not secure when we have to deal with something called authentication on the front end. We want to have all the logic in the backend side. We want to hide them. We don't want the user to know. Not the user, someone who knows about coding, who knows about the flow, and they can modify for some user ID. It's very dangerous, right? We don't want the user to modify anything on the front end. That's why sometimes we want to make when we have to build an app with the front end and the back end, we want to build a very stupid front end, and a very smart back end. Because front ends, their purpose is just render, show stuff, right? They should not know how to do modify stuff. Their only purpose is to show stuff and to collect information from the user and send it back to the backend. Try to make a very stupid front end, and it will make your life easier. Don't try to make it so complicated on the front end, right? Okay. Save this picture. I think this one's good.
You can add it to the
portal. Oh yeah.
Keep
okay, I think that's the last line. Everything is in this slide. Everything you need to know is inside here. Other slides just introduce you what is OAuth and why is it there in the first place, right? So what we are going to do today here is this, and start from milestone. That's a lot. Six here. It's gonna be start from 6 and 6, 7, and 8. It will be this part. So we need to handle the token on the front end app. It's hard. Right. Do you have any questions about the flow here?
Yeah.
One question. So like, if I want to use Facebook both in my website, do I need to ask permissions or how does it work that way?
All right. So I'm going to go with the flow here. You. Who are you? You are the developer.
I'm a developer and I want my
okay, user. I'm the user, right? Yeah. I'm the user. I want to log in your application with Facebook. So I will go to your site, okay? And then your site will redirect me to the backend server, okay? And you have some logic that will say redirect me, the browser, to Facebook. And there, if I want to use your application, I have to enter my password, username, password on Facebook.
Yeah, I think you misunderstood. I mean, as developers, do we need to ask permission, for example, because we need something from Facebook in this case?
Yeah,
right?
That's why we use ID and secret key. I'm gonna show you now. Developer. Yeah, here we go. I actually have an account here. Great enough. You can use your tic-tac-toe app on Facebook. Remember, you already create one. I don't think you remember. how do I log in? What the hell? Oh, here. So bad. So here's an application on Facebook. You will have to create an app yourself. So go here. Create an app. Why the hell is it so slow? Okay, got to wait, guys.
Yeah, we did this, right?
Yeah, that's why I said in tic-tac-toe.
Yeah.
And then you have to create an app, and Facebook will give you an ID, client ID, and client secret. Okay, so the ID will be here. See, this is my ID, and if you go to setting, basic. And you can actually see a secret here. So slow, oh my god. Let's see what I'm using. I don't think it's Wi-Fi. It's really fast here. Something wrong with the connection between Vietnam and this server, I guess. So you will see a secret key. I actually had it in the lab. Let's see. Right here. Okay. So if you take a look at the black box here, it's gonna be your ID, and here's will be your secret key. Okay. You will use those two strings inside your application, the backend application, and you should store it in the ENV. Okay. And when we send when we redirect to authentication server here, we actually redirect with the client ID and the secret key. See? In the URL, we attack the client ID and the secret key. And this URL is not, it's safe because user don't see it. Actually, they don't see it. Even if they see it, I don't think they will see it. It happens so quickly, they don't even see it. Right? And then we have another step to prevent if the user see those client ID and secret, it will redirect back to the backend server, to our backend server. We actually have it here. We define not here, so you can see secret key here. If you click on setting, you will also have to define the callback URL, which is the URL that the server will redirect back here, redirect to the front backend. So we need something to tell the Facebook, okay, here's the URL that you have to redirect to. And that's here, oh my god. Is it my computer?
No, it's actually not
logging to the full space. All right, so in the picture, you will have to define your callback URL. Right, it's written in the lab, don't worry. You can have as many redirect URL here as you want. For example, you can have one for localhost and one for production domain. Cool. And then just save it. And then you can use it. Simple. So after, it's right here, after Facebook asks permission from the user, right, it will redirect again to somewhere. So right now you can either tell redirect to localhost or redirect to a production domain. It's written in your code, and there's one more step to make it more secure. Facebook provide us the ability to limit or restrict, where is it? Or restrict the domain that can be redirect. For example, here, I only allow the redirect to go to localhost, nowhere else, only to localhost. Okay.
So after we keep the permission, it redirects us to localhost, like using our app on localhost.
Inside our code, we will say, okay, after you done redirect me to localhost, and in here you kind of like a restrict. I only allow to localhost, right? I also allow to my own domain. So we have two layers here. We have two things to do. The first one is like the code here to tell, okay, after you done redirect me to localhost, but there will be a problem. So what if people have your ID and secret key? For some reason, they know your ID and secret key. They can also build a backend server themselves, and they also have their own localhost, right? And they will use, they will also tell our Facebook, okay, after you're done, redirect back to their own server, which is also localhost. And that's why Facebook provide us another setting here. So right now I can redirect back to localhost, but for production, I should remove this field. Okay. After we are done, we should remove this field, and we only allow to redirect to our own domain. Remove the localhost. It's very dangerous. Like localhost exists everywhere on your computer, your Emily computer, my computer, they're all localhost. So in production mode, you should remove, after you've done everything, you should remove this box. Okay.
So it's kind of like when we finish our backend, we chain our localhost into Heroku app, so we do the same thing with this one.
Yeah, remove this one. I mean, like it's kind of different. This one is just for security purpose. If you allow to redirect back to localhost here, that means you can use my ID, my Facebook app. You can use my Facebook app. I don't want that. It's very dangerous. So you should remove localhost, but for now, don't worry too much about it, right? It's for security. Actually, I just thought of it now. It's so dangerous to have a localhost here. Okay, and that's pretty much it. Okay, let's take a couple of minutes to visualize the whole flow in your head before we actually do something in the lab. We're gonna take like 10 minute break, right? 10 minute break. Do you have any question? Yes. not yet.
I don't know.
well said. So we have the resource owner, we have the authentication server, we have resource server, and we have the backend, the API, or the client. It's going to back end. So this is my own flow. You can look up on the internet, there will be other chart or illustration. I don't know, it depends. You might find it easier to understand, or this one easier to understand. Cool. There's a bunch of stuff to do here on the front end. And people are usually get lost here, because on the back end side, once you set it up, it's done. You don't have to worry about it anymore once you set it up. But for the back end, this kind of harder. For the front end, it's kind of more tricky. And we will have login with Facebook, as well as login with email and password on the front end as well. That's why it's tricky. Right, so that's it. I'm gonna take a like 10 minute break. before we jump into the first part of the lab, which is authentication with third-party service, just on the backend, just on the backend. Okay. I'm gonna start QuickTime. Stop recording.